Jen Wilkin, who's one of our favorite Bible teachers here and who's actually leading our women's conference, she said we ought to whisper about what the Bible whispers about, and we ought to shout about what it shouts about. And the Bible appears more to whisper when it comes to sexual sin compared to its shouts about materialism and religious pride. In fact, Jesus not one time ever said that it was difficult for the same sex attracted to go to heaven. He did say it was easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than it was for a religiously proud or materialistically successful person to enter into the kingdom of God.
That's an amazing statement. That's like saying that God whispers about incest or God whispers about bestiality. I mean, yes, it's true that there are not a huge number of texts dealing with homosexual practice, but it's sort of like saying, you know, in all the churches I've ever been to throughout my life, I've never heard an evangelical pastor give a sermon about why you shouldn't have sex with your mother or your sister. But I've never deduced from that that God whispers. I've always instead concluded that not that incest is not really a big issue or it's an agree to disagree issue, but rather I've concluded it's such an irreducible minimum of human sexual ethics that to talk about it at all, even, is to some extent already a defeat for the church, because it should be absolutely a non-negotiable given by the church that this is a boundary that we can never cross. We can never even contemplate the possibility of different sides to this question. There's only one side available to that question. So again, there aren't a whole lot of texts on incest in the Bible. In the New Testament, had it not been for the case of the incestuous man at Corinth, there would be no text in the New Testament speaking against incest. Listen, every text in the scriptures that has anything to do with human sexuality, whether it be legal material or narratives or proverbs or poetry, metaphor, every kind of genre within the biblical text that has anything to do with human sexuality always presupposes a male-female requirement. There is no exception to that anywhere. And the first differentiation that occurs in sexual ethics in creation text is the differentiation between male and female. And the first discussion of any aspect of human sexuality has to do with the union of male and female into one flesh, the two halves of the sexual spectrum uniting into a single sexual whole. Why should a man become joined to a woman and the two become one flesh? Because out of one flesh they emerged. Yeah. So the entire fabric of scripture that speaks about human sexuality is predicated on this foundation: a male-female requirement, no same-sex relations. One is the flip side of the other. So this is far from being a silent matter in Scripture, is something that Scripture screams everywhere. Part of what Scripture screams here is don't ever talk in an affirming way about same-sex unions. We don't want to hear it.
Yeah.
That's where the silence is, right?
Yeah.
And if there's any threat to that foundation of human sexual ethics, then the church cannot be silent about it. It's like saying that, again, as an analogy, the case of the incestuous man at Corinth, Paul should have just been whispering this, right? Mm-hmm. You know, maybe it's not something we should really promote. Yeah. You know, instead, we have a Paul that's absolutely outraged. He says, I don't have to say, WWJD, what would Jesus do? I don't need a Jesus saying about man, mother, incest. I know what the Lord's view of it is. And in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the Lord of this church, take the following action. Remove him from your midst. You're not even to eat with such a one.